This video is going to talk about functions for 3.6 and MAT1033. Some key things I need to tell you real quickly before we start is that this section will have the most questions on the test. Each question is not going to be worth as much as some of the other sections, but there's so many important pieces for this section that it's really, really important that you double check practicing this. Maybe use the study plan later on. We have extra videos uploaded with some extra examples for finding domain and range, because that's an area we find people make mistakes. So we're going to go ahead and get started. We're going to start with a relation, and this is just a relationship between an X and a Y. We could have a mapping where you have arrows. We could have a graph. We could have ordered pairs, but it's just having some type of relationship between an X and a Y. We are going to focus today on functions. And a function is where the domain corresponds exactly with one member of the range. But I'm going to put it in a different words. This basically means the domain can't repeat. Please realize I did not say the range. The domain, which is my X coordinate, cannot repeat. So that's what you're checking anytime you're asked if something's a function or not. So in example one, we have ordered pairs. And they're asking for domain and range, and then we're going to ask if it's a function. So some key things to hit right now and remind you. When you're listing out a set, the order doesn't matter. But if you repeat yourself, it is incorrect. So domain is my X, and it may be a good idea to write that always below it. So my domain is 9 and 2. The 9 repeats, I do not list it twice. The range is my Y, so negative 5, 5, and 4. Always scan it, make sure you didn't list something twice, and that's it. That's the domain and range. Determining if it's a function looks to see, does the domain repeat? And the domain did repeat. So it's not a function. If they ever ask you to explain why, you're always saying, does a domain repeat? Going to my second ordered pair set, again, my domain is my X values, which are my first coordinates, so 6, 4, and negative 2. My range is my Y coordinates, which is 3 and 1. The 3 repeats. I do not list it twice. The next question is this a function? And you're testing, does the domain repeat? So in this case, my answer is yes, it's a function. I had 3 unique X values for this problem. So one way to find domain and range is looking at ordered pairs. Not a hard question, but again, I get people that miss it. Please double check that you're listing it correctly. So second idea in this section is function notation. I've oftentimes always said that math people do not like to write things out. We want shortcuts. So I want you to think of function notation as a shortcut. Now, if it's a function notation, it has to follow the rules. The domain cannot repeat. But it's just a shorthand for saying, if I wanted to say before in the last section, I had y equals 2x plus 3, I had to say to y'all, let x equal 4, what is y? I had to write it out, or I had to put it in a chart. I can now rewrite this function, f of x equals 2x plus 3. Notice what I did. I took the y out. I took the y and replaced it with f of x. And what this does for me is now instead of having to say x equals 4, what is y, I can say f of 4. And that tells you x equals 4, what is y. So all that's doing is asking you to substitute in for your variable. So I would have f of 4 equals 2 times 4 plus 3, 8 plus 3, which is 11. I'm still getting an ordered pair. I get the ordered pair of 4, 11. So that doesn't change. It's just a notation that's changed. Now, something I recommend is anytime you're doing this function notation, I want you to think of f of x as being a shell. And so I want you to always, always put parentheses down first when you're writing down that form. So this would be 2 times parentheses minus parentheses plus 3. So notice I didn't put anything down, but I'm not going to be confused once I plug in this case, 0, on what I do. So I'm clear. The exponent only goes with what it's touching unless there's parentheses. So we do the exponent first. So 0 squared is 0. That will be a 0 minus 0, which is 3. My answer for the answer blank is 3. But I want you to understand this is the point 0, 3. I plugged in an x value of 0. I got a y value of 3. But in this case, when it said find f of 0, my answer was 3. Same idea for B. Start with the shell, and I cannot stress enough, really important to put the parentheses down, especially when you have a square involved. So I'm plugging in a negative 7, because that matters in this case. I am squaring the x, so I'm squaring the negative 7, so that's going to be 49. So 2 times 49, that becomes a plus 7. 2 times 49 is 98. So I get 98 plus 10, which is 108. So my answer is 108. The point is negative 7, 108, but the answer is 108. It's just shortcut. It's all it is. It's giving the y value. It's saying, at this x value, what is the y? So for my last one, write the shell down first. Plugging in 3. And now I'm going to do my exponents, my order of operations. So 3 squared is 9. I get 18, and these essentially cancel out. So I have 18 as my answer. So again, my answer here is 18. I got the ordered pair 3, 18. Not hard, but you got to know the notation. You will have this on test 2 and test 3. So D, we're still dealing with function notation, but this throws people off as well. It's asking for looking at the graph, so it didn't give you an equation. But remember what this is asking. This is find f of 0. This is saying when x is equal to 0, what is y? That's what that's saying. So when I look at this drawing, I say when x is 0, what is y? Y is equal to 1. That's my answer. Second one is saying, when x is equal to 2, what is y? So when I look at this drawing here, when x is equal to 2, y is equal to 3. And my last one, when x is equal to negative 1, I'm on the axis, so it's a y value of 0. So remember, f of x is just asking for y. So you're just finishing the ordered pair. It's just a different way of asking the question. So vertical line test, it's also asking if it's a function. I want you to remember, if I ask about a function, you're asking, does a domain repeat? Well, if I draw a vertical line and I touch it at 2 spots, that means it has the same x value. So that's all a vertical line test is doing, is it's really just saying, does the domain repeat? But it's a piece that you can visually look at. So the first drawing here is a parabola. Any vertical line that I draw is going to touch it at 1 spot. So this is a yes, it is a function. My second one is my circle. This is such an important thing in math, a circle is, but it's not a function. Because if I draw a vertical line here, I touch my graph at 2 spots. Looking at my third graph, this one is a function because I can draw a vertical line and only touch it at 1 spot. And my last one is yes as well. The only linear equation that is not a function, so the only one, is if I had a vertical line. If I had a vertical line, that would not be a function. But I want you to think about it. If I had a vertical line, it would be an x equals. So it doesn't even have a y to replace it with. That's y. So every linear equation is a function except that one special case. So this is the part that we have extra examples on. So if you struggle with this, which a lot of people do, you want to watch more videos for more examples. This whole section doesn't take a lot of time, problem by problem, but it's got a lot of information packed into one. So I am going to write down the rules for domain for any equation because you're going to see it in three tests and the final. So it's that important. So when we talk about a domain, remember a domain is what value can I plug in for x? That's what I'm asking. What values work for x? So we're going to start off assuming our answer is all real numbers. So remember, that's negative infinity to infinity. If I was talking about interval notation, it would mean I could plug in any negative value, any positive value, any decimals, any fractions, and it would work. And what I mean by work is it means it's going to give me a real number back. So our second step is going to be, so I'm going to write that as 1. We're going to assume that that's my first step. We're assuming my answer is all reals. And we're going to then look for, are there any restrictions? If your answer is no to this question, your answer is all reals. You're done. What we are now looking for restrictions are two cases. And so I'm going to write them both down now. You're not going to run into both of them in this section. But I'm going to keep reminding you that there is two rules no matter what section, what chapter you're in, you will always follow the same rules. So the first rule is our denominator cannot equal 0 because that makes it undefined. So I'm going to repeat that. The denominator cannot equal 0. That makes it undefined. The second case is if I have a square root, which will be on the last test material. I cannot take a square root of a negative number and get a real answer. Some of you remember i's, you might remember complex numbers, but remember I'm trying to get a real number. So if I have this, I'm going to take whatever's underneath the radical and set it greater than or equal to 0 and solve. Those are my two restrictions. If there is a restriction, you have to limit it. Draw your picture out, do your interval notation just like we did in module 1. If there are no restrictions, your answer is negative infinity to infinity. So what I just wrote down is essentially what you have here. Fractions, we must exclude numbers that are in the denominator that make it undefined. So we take x minus 2 can equal 0, x cannot equal 2. So it doesn't ask you to sketch it, but for a lot of you, this helps. So we start off assuming my answer is all reals, which would have meant shade everything. That's what step 1 is. We assume that that's my answer. And now I've just said x cannot be 2. So I've got to take that out. So it's now broken my answer into two pieces. I start left to right, left to right. So I start at an arrow, which is negative infinity. I go to 2. I start back at 2, and I go to infinity. They all have to be open because I'm not including 2. Going to the second example, take that denominator, can equal 0, subtract 7, divide by 2. So again, I don't think it is harmful for y'all to ever draw a picture. We start off assuming my answer is all real numbers. I have now taken negative 7 halves out. So my answer, I start at an arrow, which is negative infinity. I go to negative 7 halves. I again start at negative 7 halves, and I go to infinity. I started with my answer as negative infinity to infinity, and I'm breaking it up because I'm taking that value out. Now, on number 2 examples that are listed here, I want you to stop. I know I've written it a different way there, but look. Is there any restrictions? Which means, is there a denominator or is there any square root? No. Is there any restrictions? No, there's not a denominator. There's not a square root. This last one throws people off because they see the absolute value, but it doesn't have a restriction. There's no denominator. and there's no square root. So my answer is negative infinity to infinity. If there are no restrictions, that is your answer. Not a hard concept. Please, please, please practice this. So the last piece for domain and range is going to be from a graph. So for a graph, I want to remind yourself, the domain is x values. So we're going to go left to right, just like we would have on a number line. So you're always going to go left to right. Where do I start? Where do I stop? My range is my y values. So y values start on the bottom of the graph. So we're going to start at the bottom of the graph, and we're going to go up. So we're going to say, where do we start touching it? Y value, where do I stop touching it? So, but again, I always like to do this. I write X and Y underneath, so it reminds me. Also, if it helps, you can draw an arrow. It's kind of, again, optional, but if it helps to do that, then do that. I'm going to blow this one up because, again, I'm going to use a highlighter here, and then I'm going to take it off after I do it. But I'm saying as I go left to right with my pencil, where do I start touching it? Where do I stop touching it? So left to right here on this piece. I started touching it here, and I stopped touching it here. And that's actually an arrow. So my domain, looking at those blue spots there, I start touching it at an x value of -1, and it's a colored in dot, so I'm including it. Make sure you can read that. So it's colored in, so it's -1. I stop touching it at, so I keep tracing it, don't pick up my pencil. There's an arrow there, so it's to a positive infinity. So now my y value is going from the bottom of the graph up. Where do I start touching it? Where do I stop touching it? But remember, be careful, it's y values I'm listing now. So I start touching it here, I continue to trace it all the way to there. So my y value is going to be 0, and I stop touching it at an arrow, so that's a positive infinity. Remember, smallest value can be negative infinity, biggest value can be positive infinity, and that's if you're hitting an arrow. Looking at number 2, again, for my domain, I'm going left to right. Where do I start touching it? Where do I stop? So I start touching it at this x value, and I continue to touch it at two different spots, but that's okay. I'm continuing touching it to this x value. Both of them are colored in, so that's -2 to 2. My range is going up, and it's y values. I start touching it at this y value. I stop touching it at this y value. It happens to be that these match because this is a circle centered at the origin, but please don't assume it matches. The purple is going up the graph for my range. The orange was going left to right on my graph. My last one, which is an absolute value problem, again, as I go left to right on my graph, I start at an arrow and I stop at an arrow. So my domain should be negative infinity, infinity, which, real quick, that was this one here. Absolute value means I can plug anything I want, which is what I should have gotten from this graph. I start, so again, I start at an arrow, keep tracing it for x values, and I stop at an arrow. My range is going from the bottom up, and again, I'm saying, where do I start touching it? Well, I start touching it at this y value, and I'm touching it on both sides, and I stop touching it at an arrow. So my range is a y value of 0 to infinity.